looking at the rewind motor from the Bell and Howell taken apart. As you can see, it is a standard squirrel cage induction AC motor. These motors are very common in fans and other household appliances. Now, normally you would not have to take one of these motors apart, but in a 55-year-old machine, even with the strong bearings that have been put into the motor, dirt and grime get in there. I'm going to lube it and oil it and put it back together, and it will be perfect. It's very heavy. It weighs about 2.5-3 pounds. And this is the cord that plugs into the amplifier board. This is the mounting plate. And the way it goes together is rather simple. This end here, and I've got it over the hole in the table so it can slide through, simply slides in, and that spins. As you can see, it's spinning. It hasn't been oiled yet. And then the cap simply goes on top of it. I have the motor all cleaned up. One thing that I wanted to point out to you is that if you look in the back of some of these motors, you'll see these holes here, and it looks like dust bunnies are in those holes. Those aren't dust bunnies. That's a wool pack. It's like a string of wool that they've wrapped around the bearing, and it's on both sides of the motor. What you can do is you can take a precision oiler like this, which is actually, it's a kind of a syringe. You don't get it at a medical supply store, you can get it at a hardware store. You can very gingerly put some of the oil onto the wool packing. The wool packing will absorb it and transfer it to the bearing. And that is what keeps the motor nice and fresh. So we have the motor rebuilt, and you can see how freely it spins. Watch this spin. So that's about as free as that motor is going to get. We're looking at the capstan flywheel idler wheel motor drive assembly along with the take-up motor assembly, which is all on this single plate. The capstan, as you can see, is not that big around in diameter, but it is very thick, and we can look at that by taking out the drive wheel for a moment, and I'll lift out the capstan, and you can see how thick that is. Now, that's quite amazing. It's very heavy, too. It's about 2 or 3 pounds. And it has a curved back here on the tail, not a ball bearing, that sits in this socket here. And, of course, that allows it to spin. Now, none of this has been restored yet. What's also interesting are these 6 channels that they cut into it. I'm not sure if that is to balance it or to allow the passage of air, because this machine gets very hot. The idler was a little bit dried, but I was able to clean it up with CLR, and it came out pretty good. The motor turns, of course, obviously, changes direction, and it turns the capstan in the same direction. But if the motor were to run backwards, there would be no traction. And that's because there's no spring in this system. Instead, this has a weight on it right here, and that weight pulls this down. Now, obviously, this is a mock-up, so it's not going to be working as well as it does in the actual tape recorder. And you see, here we are at the higher speed. Now, the take-up table is here, and I'm going to put the 7-inch empty reel here to show you how this is not very free right now. You notice that when I try to spin it in the proper direction, or even in the reverse direction, it really does not want to spin. Now, there's nothing wrong with the take-up table itself. It's the motor has just got 55 years of gunk in the bearings. Solution is real simple. Take that apart, clean it, put it back together. And the same thing is true of the drive motor. I have the take-up motor and the drive motor all cleaned up and back in the mounting plate. We'll put the reel on it and then give it a spin. So you can see how that's spinning very nicely. Now, one of the reasons I'm very concerned about this motor is because it is going to do more work than just move the tape. There is a belt here, which is a spring belt, and the belt is adjustable. There are ends on here. The two ends just kind of screw together, so you can kind of pull it together a little bit more to create some more tension. It's a very, very small amount that you can go, maybe about an eighth of an inch. But that spring belt goes on the end of the table there, and it hooks to an odometer. So you can see it's still able to spin quite freely. The Bell and Howell has a three-digit counter, similar to what we see in more modern machines. But this counter is unusual in that it has no reset wheel and no reset button. They call it an odometer. It's probably based on automobile odometer design. The Bell and Howell uses a solenoid to engage and disengage the pinch roller from the capstan. Now, in this mock-up, this battery is representing the capstan. Here is the pinch roller on the plate that carries it. Here are the two tape lifters that pull the tape away from the head. And this lever here also works the pressure pads, which are part of the machine. This is the actual solenoid. It's a rotating solenoid, so that when power is put to it, it rotates this plate, and that causes the pinch roller to come up against the capstan. This stays energized as long as you're playing the tape. When you push the stop button, the energy is released, and a return spring located here pulls this down, and the whole thing disengages. Thank you for watching the video on this Columbia Bell and Howell vintage tape recorder. If you are just starting the video, please continue with the series. If you're in the middle of the series, please review anything that you haven't seen so that you don't miss anything about this very fascinating vintage machine from 1955.